In our current moment of stagnating wages and growing inequality, some people have floated the idea of reviving the labor movement as a potential way forward. So I think it's worth looking back at the history of unions in the United States. For as long as they've existed, unions have faced persecution and violence at the hands of big business and the US government. When groups of employees stand together and threaten to withhold their labor to demand higher wages, it jeopardizes a business's bottom line. As a result, bosses have never been afraid to use violence to break strikes or discourage unionization. In 1877, tens of thousands of railroad workers went on strike to protest wage cuts. In response, the railroad companies organized militias to break strikes, aided by federal troops. Pennsylvania Railroad President Thomas A. Scott remarked, "Give them a rifle diet for a few days and see how they like that bread." True to that statement, militiamen shot a group of striking workers in Pittsburgh, then charged them with bayonets, killing 40 and wounding several others. In 1887, a group of black sugarcane planters went on strike in Thibodaux, Louisiana. Militias funded by the plantation owners attacked the planters and their families, leaving 60 dead. What were the strikers' demands? To be paid in U.S. currency instead of papers only redeemable at the plantation store. Those that survived went back to work in slavery-like conditions, and no attempt would be made to organize sugarcane workers until the 1950s. The 1894 Pullman strike highlights many themes of the labor movement's struggle. For one, the government once again supported the bosses rather than the workers, sending 12,000 federal troops to crush the strike. Because the strike featured 250,000 workers and shut down railroad travel west of Michigan, President Grover Cleveland wanted to end it quickly and was willing to use deadly force. In the Pullman strike, we can also see the conflict between radical and conservative unionists. Labor leaders like Big Bill Haywood, founder of the Industrial Workers of the World, believed that instead of just fighting for wage increases, unions could play a role in overthrowing capitalism. More conservative leaders, like Samuel Gompers, emphasized a friendly working relationship between workers and employers, and labeled the IWW as Bolsheviks. Another area where the radical IWW and conservatives like Gompers disagreed was on the issue of who was allowed into their union. Gompers made his union group, the American Federation of Labor, exclusive to skilled white male workers. He had a problem with female, African American, and unskilled laborers because they often worked for lower wages, undercutting his people. Rather than working alongside these other groups so they could fight for better conditions together, Gompers sought to keep them out of the workforce. In the Pullman strikes, Gompers sided with the government because the striking workers of the American Railway Union were mostly unskilled laborers rather than craftsmen. Instead of acting in solidarity, Gompers ordered AFL workers to refrain from striking in support of the American Railway Union. Feeling betrayed by the government and the conservative wing of labor, ARU leader Eugene V. Debs would go on to become a major figure in the U.S. socialist movement. Another thing to come out of the Pullman strike was the holiday Labor Day, which President Cleveland recognized in an attempt to reconcile with organized labor. It was his way of saying, "Sorry for sending in 12,000 federal troops to make sure you don't get a pay raise. Thanks a bunch, Grover." So, despite attacks from business owners, private militias, the government, and rival unions, organized labor still managed to win major victories. In the coal strike of 1902 and the Lawrence textile strike of 1912, workers faced down their bosses and came away with pay raises. Contrary to what you might hear, things like better pay, shorter working hours, and better safety regulations were not handed down by bosses out of the goodness of their hearts. They were fought for by workers, often at the cost of their lives. Unions were also an important part of the fight for racial justice. Although some union leaders, like Gompers, continued to exclude non-whites, others viewed the struggle for workers' rights as being intertwined with the struggle for civil rights. Because radical unions like the IWW saw the union movement as part of a project of liberation, they included women and minorities in their unions and supported voting rights for women and African Americans. Likewise, leaders of the civil rights movement saw the labor movement as an important ally. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., for example, believed that because unions emphasized human dignity and control over one's own life, the struggles for worker power and civil rights were essentially the same struggle. There was also a practical reason for unions to promote racial solidarity. If a union only accepted whites, bosses could bring in black people as strikebreakers and turn the labor dispute into a race issue. If white workers were busy getting angry about black or immigrant workers, then bosses could play the groups against each other and make them compete for scraps. If white and black workers came together and organized around their shared interests, then the bosses would be forced to pay higher wages to everyone. From the late 1800s into the early 1900s, organized labor made big gains for workers of all stripes, man and woman, black and white, American-born and immigrant. This progress was won in spite of violent pushback from businesses and the government. The early 20th century, for example, saw some of the most violent conflict between labor and big business. The Battle of Blair Mountain featured local law enforcement bombing coal miners from airplanes, and the Colorado Labor Wars saw hundreds of casualties in what was basically a full-scale war over working conditions. Despite the repression, labor fought on. Unfortunately, the fledgling unions would face another obstacle in the form of the first Red Scare, the wave of paranoia that swept through the US following the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917. Due to the focus on worker power inherent in the labor movement, and the presence of socialists and communists in its ranks, unions became a target for crackdown. Union workers were portrayed as Soviet agents, and propaganda suggesting that strikes were a slippery slope towards Bolshevik barbarism was common. President Woodrow Wilson's government led a crackdown on unions, Italians, Eastern European Jews, and other groups suspected to have communist sympathies. While the recently formed U.S. Department of Labor fought against this mixture of racism and red-baiting, Attorney General A. Mitchell Palmer made about 10,000 arrests in what became known as the Palmer Raids. The government attack on unions, aided by red-baiting propaganda, would severely hamper union organization efforts. After being demonized during the Red Scare, unions would see a reversal of fortune when the stock market crashed in 1929, sinking the U.S. into the Great Depression. President Herbert Hoover's failure to respond to the Depression discredited his small government pro-business economics, which led the American people to look for an alternative. Another approach would be offered by Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the governor of New York, who advocated the use of government programs and labor unions as a way to make sure Americans had good, well-paying jobs. FDR won the 1932 presidential election with labor's backing, and he viewed unions as a vital part of his coalition and his political program. In the following years, Congress passed the National Labor Relations Act, or Wagner Act, which guaranteed rights to union organization and striking, as well as creating the National Labor Relations Board to oversee labor disputes. Under pressure from Roosevelt, the Supreme Court ruled that minimum wage laws were constitutional in the case West Coast Hotel versus Parrish. This ended the Lochner era, named for the 1905 Supreme Court case which held that states could not make laws that limited work hours. Other advances in labor law came with the Norris-LaGuardia Act of 1932, which banned courts from issuing injunctions to stop strikes, and the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938, which banned oppressive child labor and made overtime pay mandatory. Due to these advances in labor law, unions grew stronger. Membership increased sharply through the Roosevelt era, going from around 4 million in 1935 to 14 million by the end of World War II. After siding with big business for so long, it seemed like the government was finally embracing unions, but this would not last. Following World War II, with the fascist powers defeated, the Soviet Union once again loomed large as the greatest threat to the United States. At the same time, the union movement was growing ever more powerful and bold in its demands. Like the first Red Scare, conservative politicians argued that unions were a potential hotbed of Soviet influence, posing a serious threat to the United States, and pushed for laws that would limit the power of the labor movement. The 1946 Administrative Procedures Act made it more difficult for the National Labor Relations Board to intervene in labor disputes, which would give big business an advantage over unions. The 1947 Taft-Hartley Act further diminished labor power by banning several types of strikes, preventing unions from making political donations, and allowing states to pass right-to-work laws. Right-to-work laws ban mandatory union membership in workplaces, allowing employers to hire workers who will not be part of or pay dues to unions, effectively splitting the workplace and making it more difficult for unions to operate. Right-to-work laws exist in 26 states today. The Second Red Scare also featured a wide-ranging crackdown on communism within the labor movement. Taft-Hartley, for example, required union leaders to sign affidavits saying they weren't radicals who wanted to overthrow the government. This trend would continue throughout the 1950s with legislation like the Landrum-Griffin Act, which banned members of the Communist Party from holding union office. While the Supreme Court ruled that it was unconstitutional to bar someone from union leadership based on their political party, unions voluntarily purged left-wing radicals from their ranks rather than dealing with the bad press. Following Taft-Hartley, the United Auto Workers purged some of their leadership for refusing to sign the anti-communist pledge. The CIO, or Congress of Industrial Organizations, one of the biggest union federations, followed suit in 1948, kicking out any leadership with communist ties. Of course, this purge wouldn't stop rabid anti-communists like Barry Goldwater from attacking unions. During a hearing in 1964, Goldwater claimed that CIO leader Walter Reuther was more dangerous to the United States than anything coming out of the Soviet Union, despite the fact that it was Reuther who purged the communists from the United Auto Workers. So here's why the expulsion of left-wing radicals is important. If you were a communist or a radical socialist, you strongly believed in the idea of class struggle and worker power, and you were willing to put your body on the line when it mattered, whatever the consequences. So by purging their radical members, unions were getting rid of the people most invested in the struggle for worker power. With the communists and socialists gone, the leadership falls to workers who don't see the union as a political project for advancing the interests of working people. But the Second Red Scare didn't destroy the union movement outright. If we look at the percentage of workers in unions, it stayed constant throughout the 60s. However, what it did do was leave the unions unprepared for what was to come. Now, just to back up a little, when the dust of World War II settled, the US was the only major power that wasn't completely destroyed. The factories and infrastructure of Japan, the Soviet Union, and pretty much every country in Europe were devastated. But people still needed manufactured goods. So the United States, with a developed industrial base that went completely untouched in the fighting, became the goods producer for the entire world. If you bought a product made in the factory in the late 40s, it was probably made in the US. As you might guess, this was amazing for American companies. They had the market cornered on everything because there was no competition. This was also good for American workers, because instead of fighting the unions and breaking strikes, the level of profit was so high that companies had no problem with agreeing to pay raises. Unfortunately for US companies and workers, this was not going to last forever. By the mid-50s, the previously devastated industrial powers had all rebuilt their nations, and were producing more than they had pre-World War II. If we look at the rate of profit in the US, we can see that it's going down from 1946 onwards, as competition from Europe, Japan, and the rest of the world increases. Previously, corporations were willing to make deals with unions, but with the US losing its monopoly on manufacturing, there was less money to go around. Combine that with an oil crisis and two brutal recessions, and by the mid-70s, the compromise between labor and big business was not going to last. Labor and capital were both used to getting a certain amount of money, but with the profits disappearing, someone was going to have to give up their share. The solution, spearheaded by the administrations of Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan, would be to break the power of the unions. Carter and Reagan did this in three main ways. First, Carter deregulated heavily unionized industries, like trucking and the airlines. Reagan would follow with more deregulation. Second, by hijacking the National Labor Relations Board. In order to keep labor in check, Reagan stacked the board with his own people. The NLRB had previously been an important ally to the labor movement, but under Reagan, it consistently ruled in favor of big business. Lastly, Reagan set out to show the labor movement that it had no friends in Washington. He would get his chance to prove it with the 1981 PATCO strike. PATCO was the Air Traffic Controllers Union and had supported Reagan's presidential campaign. In a shocking betrayal, Reagan fired every one of the 11,400 striking PATCO members and barred them from federal employment. In addition to reducing labor power outright, Reagan's union-busting measures served as an invitation for employers to pursue anti-union policies, and a weakened NLRB meant that they were less likely to be punished for labor violations. While Reagan's showdown with PATCO was one of the most dramatic union-busting efforts, another factor would significantly contribute to their decline. Along with policies of deregulation and lower taxes, Reagan also advocated for free trade, but it wasn't until the Clinton administration that the dream of free trade would be realized. As I mentioned before, American companies were struggling to compete with foreign companies that could pay their workers less. Trade deals like NAFTA or the US-China Relations Act would make it easier for companies to move their factories to poorer countries like Mexico or China, trading the high costs of unionized American workers for the low costs of non-unionized Mexican or Chinese workers. Many union workers lost their jobs because of free trade deals, and everyone lost bargaining power because their factory could be the next to get moved. Of course, many of these workers were able to find new jobs, but they were often low-paying service jobs instead of well-paying union jobs with benefits. Going from a union job to a non-union job means less bargaining power and therefore a lower salary. Looking back at the history of the American labor movement, unions have been incredibly important in empowering American workers. They fought for higher wages, shorter work days, and better working conditions, often at the cost of their lives. And all these gains aren't theoretical. If we look at the research, higher unionization leads to higher wages, fewer workplace fatalities, less income inequality, and a smaller gender wage gap. Also, unions are a way to achieve racial solidarity by uniting workers around their shared interests, and have played a major role in the battle for civil rights. But the American labor movement was hamstrung from the start. Big business violently suppressed union organization with the help of the government, and conservative politicians portrayed unions as dangerous and anti-American. As a result, unions in the US never grew to the same strength that unions in Europe did. Many European countries had peak union membership at well over 50% of the working population, while the US topped out at about 30% in the 1940s. Despite this, unions still played an important role in the broadly distributed wage growth following the New Deal. In the post-Reagan era, where unions have largely been defeated, income inequality continues to rise with no end in sight. Since World War II, the purging of radical union members, legislation like Taft-Hartley, deregulation, Reagan's overt union busting, and globalization have eroded the power of unions, and the decline of labor power has allowed wages to stagnate. Bringing unions back would be a step towards economic democracy, giving workers greater control over their wages and production decisions. Also, unions are a great way to organize people politically. Unions can mobilize people for campaigns, large-scale strikes, demonstrations, or other political actions. With all this in mind, it's hard to see a path forward for the left that doesn't involve reviving the labor movement. Thank you for watching.